Life is not about how much we can get out of the universe. It is really about how much we have been able to give back to the universe. There are many ways in which you can give back. But there is one way by which the most intelligent give back. It's through innovation. Innovations are needed to solve the most challenging problems that we face. Challenges in the areas of sustainability, technology, education, energy, life sciences. Express your intelligence by solving some of the big challenges we face, and you will become innovation.
Good evening, everyone. Can you hear me? Because I cannot see you. I need to hear something back. I hope you all are having a wonderful day, and this evening is going to be even better. I'm Praful Kulkarni. I am the chair of PAN-IIT this year, and it's my extreme pleasure to invite you all to this evening. So, let me hear an applause for Pratish and Viti. What a great job, great team, and I'm delighted to be here. I want to tell you something about Blake Irving. Blake is a friend. He is the CEO of GoDaddy. And there is a lot of buzz I'm hearing. It's the world's largest domain name provider and a web host. So our commonality, I have an MBA from Pepperdine, and so does Blake. That's how we know each other. And we did an entrepreneurial workshop, and that's how I met him. So he's had a wonderful career, and it's not ending very fast. He's on to bigger and better things. Among other things, he was the executive vice president and chief products officer for Yahoo. He was with Microsoft for 15 years as a corporate VP for Windows Live program. He taught at Pepperdine in between, and he actually has spent time in Houston working here. So here's to the energy capital. And he's done this whole career thing about mashing up and innovation. So I want to welcome Blake.
Hi, Praful. Thanks. Well, he's not kidding when he says you can't see anything past the podium. Now, what you see before you right now is a mashup. Mashup's an interesting term, and I think it's used pretty commonly today when it's talking about technology. But mashup is a lot more than that. I'm a personal mashup. I'm a personal mashup of technology, of music, of art, of things that I've done in my history. I studied music. I actually studied art in undergrad, but I fell in love with technology. And that mashup has given me some interesting vision that sometimes other people haven't had, or I've been just a little bit ahead. I think something that music and art allows you to do is allows you to make some pretty big mistakes, to learn from them very quickly and correct them. And the best technologists that I know do exactly that. And that mashup is what I'm going to talk about today in my brief remarks. Now, most of you don't know me. Praful does, a few of you might. I've made a career in technology, even though that odd background of mine. I've done products like a product for a company called Compaq Computer that was here in the late 80s, early 90s. I was with them and did a mashup of musical, basically D to A's and A to D circuitry on a motherboard with, you know, processing and memory and disk, and actually was pretty early in multimedia. And then, you know, nobody was really thinking about it. It was very, very early. From there, I went to Microsoft, built something called NetMeeting, which was video conferencing. It was audio on the internet. And we were trying to figure out how to do that on a 56K piece of bandwidth. So we were mashing up all of this technology and trying to figure out how to stuff it down a pipe that was the size of a straw. It was incredibly difficult. We thought ISDN was going to be massive bandwidth. And now, you know, we're disappointed if we have 10 megabits. After that, I did something called Hotmail after Sabir Bhatia brought that company to Microsoft, did some work around something called Passport, built something called Ad Center. Just a lot of really interesting technologies that were a mashup of the possibility of what maybe advertising might look like in a digital world, or what something that was physically thought of in a physical world could look like digitally. And that's sort of what I've done with my life. Now, mashup's not a new term. It's not a new phrase. It's been around for a long, long time. Let's think about music for a minute. Jazz is a pretty interesting concept. Jazz is a mashup of blues, of European orchestral music, and a mashup of those two things that allowed people to do unheard of things in music that didn't make sense. That was a mashup. Rock is a mashup of R&B, of country, and folk. Now, it's hard to predict the future in technology because existing trends mash up with things that are actually looking backwards. And you have to actually take those things in pretty creative ways, put them together in a mash that can frankly change the world. So let's think about what trends are happening right now that are, I guess I'll call it mashable. Machine learning, big data, predictive analytics, smart machines, client architecture, mobile devices everywhere, personal cloud computing, 3D printing, and client architecture. And the combination of all those things mashed up in a way that you don't really think about them today. Now, so let's just take personal cloud. If you take personal cloud or cloud computing, which we used to think of as just big data centers doing large amounts of work, plus mobile, and then apply it to old concepts like music, and what do you end up with? You end up with Pandora, you end up with Spotify, and you end up with world-changing trends. So I don't know how many of you still have vinyl. How many people still have vinyl? I do. I kept it, and my wife was so pissed at me for carrying that, you know, I don't know, hundreds of pounds of vinyl with me. How about CDs? How many folks have CDs? Now, it turns out you're finding a resurgence in vinyl, and CDs are actually starting to disappear because the difference in quality between CD and streamed music, whether it's on Spotify or Pandora, is pretty slim. But you still get that warmth of music off of a vinyl record. It's just different. But think about this. Big data, a personal computing device that's in your pocket, a client architecture that allows you to actually buffer incredibly well and produce a music stream that is, you know, 64 KB, that is absolutely marvelous in quality, that's a mashup, and nobody thinks about it. It just happened. It's a trend that looks backwards and applies new technology to it. Let's think about a couple of others. Same thing. Client architecture and broadband. Like, we don't have to worry about a 56K connection anymore. We don't have to worry about 10 megabits. You actually can get, you know, I know guys that are getting 50, 100 megabits through Timo in Maui, for crying out loud. And they're streaming movies on their mobile device all the time, taking something that existed not that long ago. DVDs, not happening. You know, you've watched quite a few companies actually go out of business trying to cross the chasm between getting that old technology and moving into something that's mashed up, both bandwidth, personal computing, small devices, and streaming technology all served up from big data. Now, you think of big data and you say, well, how can you conceptualize Netflix as big data? Anybody want to make a guess where Netflix is hosted today? Amazon, exactly. So they're on AWS. Like lots and lots of big data applications actually host on somebody else's back end and just show up as a nice friendly app streamed into a nice piece of client software that does a great job actually separating client from service and server. Next, how about machine learning and natural language? I don't know how many folks are actually using Siri today. My first job at Microsoft in 1992, and I actually did some of this at Compaq, was working on speech recognition for personal computers. We actually had just enough processing power on computers back in 92 between a 386 or a 486 processor where you could utter phrases at your computer and it would try to understand you. There was a software company called Dragon Systems that was a very early pioneer in building speech recognition software. Now today, and that's not new technology. It's been around for a long time. It was used in the military well before Dragon was using it. And now you have the ability through Siri, as an example, on Apple, to command your phone to do, or command other applications on your phone to do whatever you want. That's another really interesting mashup as well. Now, how many folks have heard of Waze? How many folks are using it? Okay, very few of you. So Waze is a killer application for those of you who are not using it. And if you drive in Houston, which many of you do probably, you gotta have this app. So what this app does is it mashes up social technology with client technology and builds signal strength through enough bandwidth that can actually tell you by all the other folks that have to be using the application where traffic is having problems. And it's not just messaging from the community that's saying, hey, we got a problem on the 405 or we have a problem on the 59. It's actually watching the signal on those devices tell you how quickly they're going and how close they are together. So if you're getting signal from a bunch of different devices that start to get closer together and a lot slower, you can actually make some pretty strong assumptions about what's going to be happening at that particular point in time. That's a mashup. I think one of the coolest mashups, I'm a car guy, I'm an unabashed car guy, and I was at the Formula One race in Austin, Texas a couple of weeks ago. And was hanging out with the Lotus team. Now, it turns out that the Lotus team, if you can believe this, takes 90 seconds to go around the track, roughly. The Lotus team actually collects 300 megabytes of data per lap. 30 sensors on the car producing 300 megabytes of data that are being analyzed by a team in the back of what appears to be not a garage, but a lab. And they're mashing up not only the telemetry of the car and the data points, they're mashing up the computing power to send information back to that vehicle and make changes to it while it's moving, still on the track. Not only that, there is actually a limit. You won't believe this. There's a teraflop limit that Formula One puts on the ability of a team to collect data over the course of a week. You can only collect this many teraflops, and then you're done. So you have to be very judicious on how you collect it. That includes wind tunnel modeling, track performance, driver performance, all in, all of that stuff. What some ingenious guys in Formula One did. Not that they're working, you know, with a shortage of funds, because they seem to be pretty flush based on my short time with them. They've actually developed the ability to 3D model all the parts that they're getting data on. And if you think about a wind tunnel exercise, they're trying to actually optimize the ability's car to slice through the wind. They will get information from how the car is performing in the wind, immediately machine parts from a 3D modeler, and then put them back in, see how they're doing, put them back in, and then actually create the final part. Now, disconcerting to many of the drivers in Formula One, and most of them don't know it, the piece of equipment that actually protects the driver from injury, the little piece of gear that sits high atop his helmet, is made from a 3D modeling device and a dust of titanium. I don't think they'd feel super good about that. But it is an incredible mashup of something that's very old. Racing technology's been around a long time, and all of these wonderful models of high data, big bandwidth. In fact, that's the biggest frustration Formula One drivers have and Formula One teams have today, is the ability to actually get information back and forth from the car quickly. They'd like to get that information in 60 seconds, not 90. Mashing all that up to produce an outcome that is faster and faster and faster every year. Now, there's an Uber trend, a very large trend that affects pretty much everybody in this room, and frankly, I'd say especially in India. And I'll call it it's a growing trend, and I'll call it the producer economy. And the producer economy, and I'll just lay a definition on you, an economy where more people produce for themselves versus being employed by a secondary party. Now, this is an interesting mashup, and it's the kind of mashup that I like because it helps, I kind of define myself by the same rule. This mashup is incredibly important because it combines two things: individual entrepreneurs' passion with technology. Entrepreneurs' passion for what they do and technology. So, think about this for a minute. You're an entrepreneur and you want to start a business. You don't have enough money to start a brick and mortar business. You actually have to figure out how to do something that's substantive, that's got import, that makes me look like I'm big, makes me look like I'm real. How do I do that? Well, if you think about the mashup of technology that's allowed somebody to take their passion, and I'll just use a restaurateur as an example. He wants to start a restaurant, wants to have a presence, wants to see what it's going to look like, wants to have a web presence, wants to get found. In order to be perceived as a real company, all they have to do, and I'm going to reflect on the business that I'm in today, is build a website, make sure that they've search engine optimized it, make sure that it's as beautiful as possible, name it so it's easy to find, make sure that there are services that make it easy to find that are out there, get it listed everywhere possible, and then they're off to the races. Now, that could be a plumber, it could be a consultant, it could be an accountant, it could be a restaurant, it could be whatever kind of entrepreneur you are. Now, I sat on a panel back in New York City, and it was an interesting group of folks. It was I know I don't fit the demographic, it was a women in engineering conference, and I was speaking on this panel. And the panel was about entrepreneurs and women entrepreneurs, and they were all technology folks. Now, I'm a technology person. Most entrepreneurs are not technology people. The power of technologists is to take what we do and apply it to people that don't have a hope of doing it themselves. So if you can help somebody really easily account for how much money they make and how much money they spend, account for communicating with customers, account for acquiring and retaining customers, account for doing all the things that they have to do to create a viable business, if you can do that yourself, and you're technology people in here, if you can help them do that, you've changed the lives of tens of millions of people that are incredibly passionate about what they do, and they don't know technology, and they need help. That is this Uber trend of the producer economy. Now, if you think about the United States for a quick minute. It seems to be the place where of large businesses, of corporate enterprise, lots and lots of big successes. And the entrepreneurs that we actually pay a lot of attention to are the guys that start Facebook, or the guys that start Microsoft, or the Twitter IPO. And that's not really where most of this country's work is done. 85% of businesses in the US are five people or less. I like to call them VSBs, very small businesses. Did you know that 50% of businesses in the US are sole proprietorships? They're just trying to figure out how to make their business run. In fact, when the economy goes upside down and big businesses start to actually try to produce earnings, and the way that they tend to produce earnings is by reducing staff, reducing cost, reducing staff, reducing cost, those people turn to themselves and become the entrepreneurs that I'm talking about. Now, that panel that I sat on in New York, I think everybody in there thought that technologists equals entrepreneurs. And I'm telling you, it's not. Entrepreneurs are people with a passion, and it's our job as technologists to actually make it incredibly easy for them to do what they do, for them to be successful. Think about the companies that are out there today. GoDaddy, Squarespace, Wix, like all helping people build a website. Super simple. Get a web presence. DocStock and LegalZoom. I don't know how many folks in this room have used LegalZoom or have used DocStock. DocStock acquired by Intuit yesterday, just announced. Both of those companies, actually, the CEO, Praful, of DocStock, Jason Nazar, also a Pepperdine alum. Just thought I'd throw that out there. These companies provide legal services for a fraction of the cost of actually employing an attorney. That's a mashup of technology doing something that's been done for a long, long time, and that's the kind of technology that actually changes the world in a substantive way. There's lots of others. Loku, Facebook, Twitter, in terms of helping you acquire customers, Yelp, Angie's List. I mean, just think of all of them that are out there. Amazon, eBay, Etsy, they actually form marketplaces where you don't have to go get real estate necessarily. You can just get real estate in what's effectively a virtual mall and make sure that you're getting yourself positioned at the right corner with the right real estate so you show up when you're supposed to. Now, all of this is to say that now more than ever, technologists have a responsibility, I believe, to enable these little entrepreneurs who are trying to figure out how to become bigger businesses. Some of the folks in this room who have been successful turning something small into something big. Technologists' responsibility is to help the rest of the planet do that. At GoDaddy, actually, our vision at the company is to radically shift the global economy towards small business by making it easy for people to easily start, confidently grow, successfully run their venture, whatever it happens to be. How are we going to know we actually did that? We'll know because the proportion of the GDP that's made up by tiny businesses grows disproportionately fast compared to the rest of the GDP. And I think we are sitting on the precipice of a time when that's going to happen. I would like to think that IIT grads, regardless of whether you're an engineer, a developer, or a scientist, can help with this cause, can help these people that are trying to figure it out, trying to figure out how to get their business and make it real, trying to figure out how to be successful, trying to figure out how to take that little shop that's on a back alley some way and make it seem like it's bigger than life. How do we get to do that in a way that produces incredible gravity, incredible power for the little guy? I'd like to think all of you could do that. My 20 minutes are up. Just think about that. What can you do to help those little guys and help them grow their business? Thank you.
I have to a cool company and a cool CEO. What do you think? We want to appreciate you making this very special effort on this very cold day in Houston with an ice storm. He's got a plane ready to go to Iowa.
Iowa.
Life can be worse. So here is something that you would remember us by.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Blake. Thank you. For
my pleasure. Absolutely.
Thank you.
Absolutely. Pleasure.
This is a gift from our side to you.
Thank you. And then I land.
This is someone.
Yeah, I would make the comment, and I don't know if it occurred to all of you, but you know, when I landed here, it was like, you know, getting off a plane in Bangalore, but you stepped into the Netherlands. Like I was thinking 75 degrees. I got off, it was 32. It didn't make sense to me.
Is it a compliment?
It's an absolute compliment.
Thank you.
Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Okay, Witty is keeping us right on schedule. I need to talk to you about food. So to talk about the food, we have Teresa Cole. Teresa, are you gonna come and tell us about the food?
Welcome, everyone. As you can see, we have a very full room, and we want to make sure that this goes very smoothly. As you can see, there are letters on your tables. Everybody notice if you are A through F, as well as the buffets have letters as well, A, B, C, D, E, and F. Sharish, you are in the audience. Sharish is going to be helping me. He will be releasing a few tables to each of the buffets. Please remain seated until your table has been released. It's very important so that we can do this very quickly and systematically. Thank you all so much.
So enjoy dinner and we'll be back.